रब्बी शरहली सदरी वयस्सिरली अमरी वहलुल उक़दतम मिन लिसानी यफ़क़हू क़ौली। परवरदिगार मेरा सीना खोल दे और मेरे काम को मेरे लिए आसान फरमा दे और मेरी ज़बान की गिरह सुलझा दे ताकि लोग मेरी बात समझ सकें।
बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। अस्सलाम अलैकुम डियर स्टूडेंट्स, हाउ आर यू ऑल? आई होप यू ऑल आर डूइंग वेरी वेल। आई एम मिस फौजिया अल्ताफ एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट द फर्स्ट ईयर बायोलॉजी स्टार्टिंग फ्रॉम द चैप्टर नंबर 1 एंड दैट इज अबाउट सेल स्ट्रक्चर एंड फंक्शंस। Before starting the lesson, I would like to share a quotation, and that is about the education. Education is our passport to the future, for tomorrow belongs to the people who prepare for it today. So today's topic of discussion is about the cell theory and the different techniques that are used in cell biology. And today we are going to discuss about 4 different techniques that are used in cell biology, and that are cell fractionation, differential staining, micro dissections, and tissue culture. Before starting the lesson, I would like to remind you to have a notebook and a pencil in your hand to note down the important points of the lesson. So in the previous classes, you have studied very well about the cell structure and some basic things that were related to the cell. So do you remember who actually discovered the cell? What is the name of the scientist who discovered the cell? You have learned this in your grade 9th biology. Well, the cell was discovered by a scientist named Robert Hooke in 1665. Cell is the basic unit of life. Why? Because it is the building block of complex multicellular organisms. Now, what are multicellular organisms? Multicellular organisms are the organisms that are composed of many cells, and there is a division of labor among different types of cells. So as we say, the cell is the basic unit of life. So basically, all the life activities are carried out by cell. During the mid 19th century, the formulation of cell theory took place. Now, what is cytology or cell biology? Well, it is a branch of biology that deals with the study of cell, its structure, function, and its organelles. So the different types of organelles and its structure, the function, the cell division, everything that is related to about cell are studied under the branch of biology that is known as cell biology. So many scientists have worked on different aspects of cell, and they formulated a theory, and the silent features of cell theory, the modern cell theory, are following. Number one, the cell is the fundamental unit of structure and function in living things. Now, living things include all the living things like animals, plants, microorganisms, everything. You have studied in grade 9th biology in chapter number 4, this point was discussed, that all organisms are made up of one or more cells. If an organism is made up of one cell, it is known as unicellular. If it is it is composed of many cells or more cells, it is known as multicellular organisms. A scientist named Rudolf Virchow in 1855 formulated ominous cellula e cellula, that means the cells arise, the cell arise from other cells during the cellular division. It means the cell are divided from the already existing cells. So this point is giving you a hint about that cell, there is a cell division, and as a result of cell division, new cells are formed. Point number four is cells carry genetic material that is passed to the daughter cell. Daughter cells are the newly formed cells during cellular division. Now, what is the genetic material? Genetic material is a hereditary information that is carried from parents to the offspring. Point number five is all cells are essentially the same in chemical composition. So it means if the different types of cells are basically, they are composed of same chemical compositions. There is an energy flow that is the metabolism and biochemistry that occurs within the cell. So basically, the activities of life are all about the energy flow mechanisms. So these are the basic features of the modern cell theory nowadays, and remember these points. Now let's see what are the different techniques that are used in cell biology. Different scientists use different techniques to explore the microscopic world. So first topic is about cell fractionation. Now let's see what is cell fractionation, what are the techniques that are applied to the cell. Well, cell fractionation, it is a very useful technique for the electron microscopy. What is microscopy? Microscopy is the use or handling of a microscope. So it is basically a combination of various methods, like basically it includes a homogenization and centrifugation process. So the cell fractionation is used to separate a cell organelle and the different components based upon the size and the density of different components. So the principle of cell fractionation, it basically consists of two steps. Number one is homogenization and the second one is centrifugation. As you can see in this diagram, the cells or tissues are first of all homogenized, they are mixed, and after the homogenization process, this material that is obtained is known as homogenate, and it is then centrifugated. And now let's see what is actually homogenization and what is centrifugation process. So homogenization is basically, it is the formation of homogeneous mass of cells. It is known as cell homogenate or the cell suspension. Basically, let's see what are the steps that are involved in homogenization. So number one, it involves the grinding of tissues or cells in a suitable medium with correct pH. Secondly, there must be a correct ionic composition so that the bonding can be broken down. The temperature should be maintained. And certain enzymes are used to break the cementing substances between the cells. Like for example, pectinase is an enzyme that is used to digest the pectin of middle lamella that is present between the plant cell wall. So basically, pectinase is used to break the connection between the cells. So mixture is made in a food mixer or a blender can also be used, and cells are separated and disrupted, and the resulting mixture is known as cell homogenate, and this mixture is now ready for the next step, and that step is known as centrifugation. Now let's see what is centrifugation. So basically, centrifugation is a process in which the substances are separated on the basis of their size and the densities. If what is meant by size, we say that the components are separated on the basis of their surface area, and the densities by applying which force? The centrifugal force. So remember this point, that during the centrifugation, centrifugal force is applied and the components are separated on the basis of size and densities. Now look at this example. This is a simple example that is showing that how the force is applied, and on different rotation, the speed of rotations, the components are separated by applying the centrifugal force. So this is a machine, and this machine is known as centrifuge. In this, we actually load the samples at the equal intervals, and after that this lid is closed and we set the speed and temperature, and that samples are run for either like for 5 minutes or 15 minutes. Different timings are set according to the need of the research. So the tubes are spinned. Spinning the tubes actually exert a centrifugal force on the contents, and this force helps to separate the components based upon the size and the density. Now let's see what are the different types of centrifugation. So basically there are two major ways of centrifugation. Number one is the density gradient centrifugation. Number two is the differential centrifugation. Now what is density gradient centrifugation, and what is the mechanism behind this type of centrifugation process? So basically the density gradient, it means we get some gradients and that are obtained on the basis of density. The cell components of different sizes and densities are separated in different layers. These layers are known as sediments in the tube containing the ionic medium according to the size and densities. Now look at this example. This is a blood sample, and after the centrifugation process we obtain a different sediment, different layers, and these are known as sediments. So the first layer contains the plasma. In the second yellowish layer, lymphocytes, monocyte, platelets are located. And after that there is a medium, and this is the ionic medium that was mixed with the blood. And after that medium, this sediment layer actually contains the granulocytes, and at the bottom of the tube the red blood cells are present. So this is how, by using the ionic medium and the centrifuge machine, we can apply the rotational force, the centrifugal force, and we can separate the components of a sample depending upon the size and the density. So the upper sediments have smaller and less dense components as compared to the lower sediments. It means the RBCs, the red blood cells, are more dense. Now let's see what is a differential centrifugation and what are the mechanisms behind this type of centrifugation. So basically the sedimentation rate for a particle of a given size and shape measures how fast the particle settles on sediment. You are going to confuse this statement actually. So basically what is the mechanism? The faster the rotation of the centrifuge machine, the smaller the particles will sediment. Okay, when we rotate the sample on a more speed, the smaller particles we are going to obtain, and they are going to settle down at the bottom of the tube. A series of increasing speed can be used, and I'm going to explain how this is going to help in the research. And before going into the explanation, I would like to make you familiar with a coefficient, and that is about the sedimentation coefficient. It is known as Swedberg or S values. So bigger particles sediments faster and they have higher S values. Okay, remember this point. Bigger the particle, more value of Swedberg will be. Now let's see what is a sedimentation rate. So basically sedimentation coefficients are not additive. Remember this point, why they are, we cannot add them and get the correct answer. Sedimentation rate does not depend only on the mass or a volume of a particle. When two particles bind together, there is a loss of surface area. When two different substances are joined together, there is a reduction in the surface area actually. So when we measure them separately, they will have a different Swedberg values, and when we add them after the when we add them, they do not add up to that of the bound particle. For example, in case of bacterial ribosomes, the 70S component, the subunit actually, it is composed of two subunits, 50S and 30S. So 50 plus 30 is actually not equal to 70. But when we measure the bacterial ribosome as a whole component, when these two subunits are joined together, the value we get is 70S. When they are separated, they have a value 50S and 30S. So this is how the sedimentation rate differs. So let's see what is the process behind the differential centrifugation. So basically, first of all, a homogenate is prepared and it is taken into a after filtration. Why we filter the homogenate? So that to remove the clumps or the excessive components from the mixture. After that, the filtrate homogenate is taken in a test tube, and we are going to run this sample in a centrifuge machine like for 10 minutes and at a lower speed. After 10 minutes, when we take out the sample, we will have two layers. The lower part, this region is known as pellet, and the upper region, the liquid part, is known as supernatant. Okay, remember this point, the particles that are located at the bottom of the test tube are known as pellet, and the substances or the liquid portion that is present above the pellet is known as supernatant. So after running this sample for 10 minutes, we are going to get all the nuclei of the cells at the bottom. Now we are going to use a puppet, and we are not going to actually discard this homogenate. We are going to take this homogenate in a new test tube, and we are going to run this sample for 5 minutes by increasing the rotational speed. Now the pellet region is going to contain the mitochondria, chloroplast, lysosomes and peroxisomes. We are going to take this supernatant in a new test tube, and we are going to run this sample in a centrifuge machine for 60 minutes and by increasing the rotational speed more. So after running for 60 minutes, we are going to get plasma membrane microsomal fractions, like fragments of endoplasmic reticulum and the large polyribosomes are going to be obtained in the pellet region. Again, take out this supernatant in a new test tube, run the sample at increasing speed, rotational speed, for 2 hours. After 2 hours, we are going to get a pellet that contains the ribosomal subunits and some small polyribosomes. Now pour out this supernatant, and this supernatant now contains the soluble part of the cytoplasm, and that is known as cytosol. So this is how we use the differential centrifugation technique to get different components of the cell at different intervals and by increasing the speed of the centrifuge machine. Now the second technique that is used in cell biology is about differential staining. So basically, what is a staining technique? We are going to apply this knowledge in the lab also. First of all, let's see what is staining. Staining is actually a technique that is used to differentiate between the transparent biological structures by applying various colors, dyes, or different chemicals. So basically, for example, if you are going to study about the human cheek cell, the cells are actually transparent. Scientists cannot actually visualize that transparent objects under a microscope. So it is important to give some color to differentiate between the components. Now there are different types of staining techniques, and the first one is the single staining technique, and in this type only one stain is used. For example, borax carmine is used to stain the nucleus of the cell. So this is an example of onion epidermis, and you can see a single stain is used and all the nucleuses of the cell are stained, and we can easily locate the position of the nucleus in the cell. The second technique is the double staining or differential staining. It is also known as differential staining or double staining technique. In this technique, two different stains are used. For example, if we are going to stain nucleus by hematoxylin, and cytoplasm is stained by using a chemical substance known as eosin. So, eosin is basically red in color, pinkish in color, and it is going to stain the cytoplasm, and hematoxylin is going to stain the nucleuses of all the cell. So we can actually differentiate between the two compartments of the cell. The third technique for today's discussion is about the microdissections. And what are microdissections? Let's see. Microdissections are actually done by using different technology, and first of all, microscope is the important component of this technique. So microdissections are the dissections that are done under the microscope. Nowadays, large TV screens or monitors are also used to visualize the image. Now, what are the different techniques that involve the microdissection? So first of all is the chromosomal microdissection. In this, this technique is applied in genetic and engineering techniques. It involves the use of fine glass needle to remove the genomic region or the chromosomal, some of the chromosomal part can be removed by using the fine glass needle. And the second technique is the laser microdissection, and by the use of laser, the dissection of selected cells can be performed. The last technique we are going to discuss today is about the tissue culture. Now, what is a tissue culture technique? Tissue culture is basically the growth of the cell or tissues on a chemical defined nutrient medium under sterile conditions. Sterile condition means there is no presence of any kind of microorganism like bacteria, viruses, or spores, etc. It is very neat and clean, and all the nutrients are essential nutrients are used in a proper amount. So what is the application, practical application of tissue culture technique? So basically it can be employed for both plants and animals. In plants, plant tissue culturing, we basically make a clone of a plant. Now what is a cloning? It is the production of genetically identical plants, exact the same copy of previously existing parent plant. Second is the animal tissue culture technique. In this technique, individual cells grow to form a single layer of cells over the surface of a glass plate, or we can say in a petri dish. And the application of tissue culture is basically, it is used to see any abnormality in a cell, such as cancer or any chromosomal disorders, etc., can be studied by using tissue culture technique. Now let's see how plant tissue culture, we can actually culture the tissues of plants. So basically, a small sample can be taken from a parent plant. We can study about the nutrients that are essential for the growth of a particular plant, and the tissues are placed in a growth medium that is mainly agar growth medium in case of plants, containing different nutrients and auxin. Auxin is a hormone that is responsible for the growth. And samples are developed into tiny plantlets, and these plantlets are planted into a compost for the further growth. So in this way, we are going to get exact copy of the parent plant. In case of animal tissue culture, first of all, a tissue is obtained, and these tissues are disintegrated by using the enzymes, and the cells are inoculated in a fresh culture medium. The cells are allowed to grow. A single layer of cell is formed. Some of these cells are actually they are collected and they are in a cryopreservation of cell is done for the further use in future, and some of them are subcultured in a new fresh culture medium so that more number of cells can be obtained. And in this way, we can study the behavior of cell division. We can identify the any chromosomal abnormality is there, or any kind of abnormalities can be studied by using animal tissue culture techniques. So now here comes your homework time, and try to make a small notes, handy notes for to prepare, get prepared for the exams. So the first question is about mention the silent features of cell theory. We had discussed all these points in the previous slides. Question number two is, what is cell fractionation and how it is achieved? Now, if this question is asked, you have to mention all the points you have studied, like first of the first process was to make a homogenate, and the second part was the centrifugation, and also mention the types of centrifugation and everything you have studied till now. Question number three is, what do you know about Swedberg value? Question number four, mention some techniques that involves the micro dissection. So you can also mention, you can do some research, and you can also mention some other techniques also that are using micro dissection processes. Question number five is, discuss the role of tissue culture techniques in case of plants and animals. And in this question, you can also do some research, and you can include more points that in what kind of research we use tissue culture techniques in for plants and animals, and what are the advantages. So that's all for today. I hope you liked the lesson of the first lesson of your first year biology. If you have any question, or you have any query, or you want to ask anything, you can write down in the comment section below, and I'm going to reply, inshallah. Thank you for your time, and this is the beginning of your first year biology, and prepare very well. I want to share a small tip with you all, that in the college classes, try to grab the concepts, and then make short notes, summary notes of each lesson, so that when you are going to review the lesson, you can save time actually. So see you in the next lesson, inshallah. Till that time, take care. Allah Hafiz.